I'm just passing through. How about anybody just passing through? I'm glad the old vessels that we have is all, they're wearing out. And they're decaying every single day. But I'm glad that one day I'm going to have a heavenly body in a heavenly place. Guess what? That's going to be home. The place that I live in Bessemer City, is just a passing through place, just a place to have a roof over my head. But I'm glad that I have a mansion on the other side. I don't have a room on the other side, but I'm glad I've got a mansion on the other side, and the streets are paved with gold, and the driveway is gold too. Can I get a witness in the building? Give me praise today. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for your goodness, your grace, your mercy, all that you do for us. Thank you, dear Father, for allowing us just to be in the house of God today and to be able to worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, I pray you bless every home and every family, God, that's represented here today. And Father, I pray, God, that we'd leave this place differently than the way we came. Father, I pray you bless the songs of Zion. Stir us, God, today. I pray, God, that you'd encourage every home and every family, God, that's here. There'd be one here lost. I pray you'd save them by your good grace. Father, now I pray, God, that you'd bless the preaching hour and the man of God. I pray that you'd anoint him from on high. Now, Father, I pray, God, that you'd just touch us one more time this side of heaven, and we'll love you and thank you for all that you do for us. In Christ's name we pray, and the people of God said, amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord if you can.
Oh, we got bypassed. years ago that'll take a black heart that and wash it in red blood, and you'll come out white as snow every time. Hey, I'm thankful, praise be to God, that the blood still avails. I'm thankful that God would love us enough that He'd send His only Son without spot, without blemish, that we could be washed. Here this morning, we're looking forward to what the Lord's going to do, and I want you to do this. Let's welcome our first time guest, and how we're going to do that is this. If you're here today for the very first time, I want to ask you to do something real simple. Just remain seated right there where you're at. But if you've been here before, stand up with us all over the building, and we count it an honor, count it a privilege that you've come out to worship with us today, and looking forward to what the Lord is going to do in hearts and in lives. And let's do this, fellas. If you find those that are seated, they're going to come and put a packet of information right into your hand. We want to pray with you and for you for any need that you may have. And look at Nate Dean right there. Praise the Lord. Making his serving the Lord. And that's a blessing. And thank you for coming. Let's welcome our first time here. Let's take a moment, and we're going to welcome some folk. The musicians are playing. It's fellowship time at the Lord's house.
streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love that I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing.
Here my hope is found. Here you lead that way. Do you
Today, I don't know about you. I don't ever like the church and leave the same way that I. It's because he died at Calvary for our sin, where we can live. I'm sure that there's probably people here this morning that have been through circumstances and situations that didn't think that you were going to survive. It was so difficult that you did not even want the sun to come up the next morning. But there was a Savior that died that you could live tomorrow. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, and all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth living just because.
Somebody's trying to find a way. Jesus rescues me. Never promised that the cross would not get heavy, and that you would. Me.
1 Kings chapter 1. If you're able, let's stand and we'll read the Word of God together. 1 Kings chapter number 1. And let's look down at verse number 49. 1 Kings chapter 1 and verse number 49. And if you don't have that available, Brother Todd will probably have that on the screen. You can look. There you are. Thank you, Brother Todd. 1 Kings chapter number 1 and verse number 49, the Bible said, "And all the guests that were with Adoniah were afraid, rose up and went every man his way. And Adoniah feared because of Solomon, and arose and went and caught hold of the horns of the altar." Having read that, I want to read you just a verse here out of the book of Amos. The book of Amos, in Amos chapter 3 and verse 14, said that in the day that I shall visit the transgressions of Israel upon him, I will also visit the altars of Bethel, and the horns of the altar shall be cut off and fall to the ground. So we see here in verse number 50 of 1 Kings chapter number 1 that Adoniah was afraid of the king, King Solomon, and he went and caught hold of the horns of the altar. Verse 51 said, and it was told Solomon, saying, behold, Adoniah feareth King Solomon, for lo, he hath caught hold on the horns of the altar, saying, let King Solomon swear unto me today that he will not slay his servant with the sword. And Solomon said, if he will show himself a worthy man, there shall not a hair of him fall to the earth. But if wickedness shall be found in him, he shall die. Look and turn maybe one page to chapter 2 in verse number 24. Chapter 2 and verse number 24. Now therefore, as the Lord liveth, this is a different session, a different circumstance has happened now. We're in the next chapter. Now therefore, as the Lord liveth, which hath established me and set me on the throne of David my father, who hath made me an house, as he promised, Adoniah shall be put to death this day. And King Solomon sent by the hand of Menaniah, the son of Jehoiada, and he fell upon him that he died. Then tidings came to Joab. For Joab had turned after Adoniah, though he turned not after Absalom, and Joab fled unto the tabernacle of the Lord and caught hold on the horns of the altar. It was told King Solomon, Joab was fled to the tabernacle of the Lord. Behold, he was by the altar. Then Solomon sent Benaniah, the son of Jehoiada, saying, go fall upon him. And Benaniah came to the tabernacle of the Lord and said unto him, thus saith the king, come forth. And he said, nay, I will die here. And Benaniah brought the king word again, saying, thus saith Joab, and thus he answered me. And the king said to him, do as he has said, and fall upon him and bury him. I want to preach just a little while, if God would help me, on this idea, this thought. When the altar won't work. When the altar won't work. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I pray that God, you'd help us. I ask you, God, that you'd set a watch before my lips. Help me, God, to say what you'd have said. And those things that don't need to be said, let them remain unsaid. Lord, have your will and have your way in all that goes on and all that takes place here in this hour. Speak to our hearts. We'll thank you and we'll bless you for all that you do. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. As we begin taking a look at this this story, I want to tell you of a circumstance that had happened several years back. A law student was on his way to class. It was a cold day in January. Aren't you thankful for the cold morning we had in July? Hallelujah. I just thought about that. What a blessing. But it was a cold day in January. Walking to class, and there's a young boy that was on a pond, and he was skating around on the pond, and just as he was watching there, the ice broke, and the boy fell through and began to drown right before his eyes. But without hesitation, the young law student ran to his rescue and made his way to the edge of the hole, saved the boy from death. Years go by. He finished law school, became a successful lawyer, and went on to become a judge. One day, a long-haired, dirty-looking guy is brought before him, and he had committed some serious crimes. Right away, the judge now remembered who this young man was. He asked the young man to come and approach the bench. Having done so, this young man now recognizes and remembers who the judge was. It was the same boy he had saved in that pond that day. And he said, "Don't you remember me, don't you, judge? You saved me before. When I was about to drown, you pulled me out." And he said, "Young man, that day I was your savior. Today I am your judge." We often, I feel like, come to the house of God and throw ourselves on an altar thinking that one little trip is going to fix everything. And let me say this. If your heart is right, it can and it will. However, just because you got caught in something does not mean that God is obligated to fix your problem just because you run down to an altar. See, you can, your feet can walk one way and your heart never turn the other way, and you're not doing business with God. I know it's Sunday morning, and I know this might not be exactly what you were wanting to hear, and it wasn't exactly what I was wanting to preach, but I believe this is what we need in this hour. I believe with all my heart that the mercy of God and the grace of God avails. I believe it's available. I believe that God stretches out His hand and God is calling all to come to Him. But you'll not come to Him on your own terms. You'll come to God on His terms. When you decide that I've got calling this thing, they've told on me, I'm getting in trouble, so I'll make things right now, does not mean that God's in the deal-making business. It does not mean that God is ready to take care of your situation. But if you, by faith, if you'll turn your heart to God and you'll come to God and repent, that's a word that you don't hear a whole lot in popular preaching nowadays. The Bible said this, except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. What does repent mean? It means I'm walking this way, and when I repent, I turn around and I walk in the opposite direction. I'm going a different way than the way I was going before. Too many times we come to the church and we think, well, I just run down there to the altar. I'll say a prayer. I'll go get baptized. I'll join up with that church. And then I'll just do my own thing. I'll go my own way. You're exactly right. You'll go your own way to a place called hell is where you'll go.
Yes. Amen.
When the altar won't work. We find the story here of Adoniah. We find Joab in the situation. See, what happened is Adoniah went and fell on the horns of the altar, and there was a law that if someone went and caught hold of the horns of the altar, that they were extended mercy. And the king did just exactly that. And he said, if he means business, if he stays true to his word, then I'll not touch him. Well, it hadn't gone very long at all. And Adonai's back to his own tricks, old tricks, back to his own self, back to all the mess that he was into before. And judgment comes. Well, Joab got caught up in it and said, well, it worked for him to go ahead and go catch a hold of those horns, and he didn't get judged, so I'm going to go try it too. How many times have we seen people run down to an altar because somebody else did it? Well, they thought, well, I'll just jump in on this train too, and I'll run down there too. Can I say this? There can be somebody comes right here and genuinely repents, believes on the Lord Jesus Christ, and is gloriously born again. And their friend come right beside them. And their husband come right beside them. And their wife come right beside them. And their child come right beside them. And all they did was follow somebody down to an altar, and they never mean business with God. And God will not save that person until you're willing to get real with God, until you get willing to get true with God, until you're willing to let God do business in your heart. You can come down to every altar there is. You can run through every baptism in Gaston County, and you'll still die and go to a devil's hell. You say, preacher, you act like you're glad about that. No, I'm not. I'm here to tell you. I'm here to sound the warning. I'm here to tell you the bridge is out. I'm here to tell you there's a God that will save. There's a God that can save. There's a God, the Bible said, seeks the Lord while he may be found. See, there comes a time when God will hide himself. In Genesis chapter number 3, God comes walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And he calls out, Adam, where art thou? Now this is the sovereign God of the universe. The one that created it all with simple words. He knew exactly where Adam was. He wanted Adam to know where Adam was. Adam's hiding in the bush. He's hiding from God. Over in the book of Hosea, chapter 5, verse 6 said, they shall go with their flocks and their herds to seek the Lord, but they shall not find him. He hath withdrawn himself from them. There's a time that man tries to hide from God. Man, we want to do our own thing. We want to go our own way. We want our life to be our life. The Bible said this, you are bought with a price. You are not your own. See, if you ever get saved, if you ever get good and born again, that means that you no longer belong to you. You can't do what you want to do. You might try it for a little while, but you're going to be miserable in it. And then God your Father, God my Father, when we start doing our own thing in our own way, he starts to chastise us. He starts to correct us. He starts to discipline us. That's how we know that we're one of his. If you'd be without chastisement, then you've never been born. I know we're supposed to be swinging from the chandeliers this morning. I've done a little research. Years ago, there was a guy by the name of Wilbur Chapman, and he had a big evangelistic type meeting. There were 4,500 people present, and I'll give you the numbers, but I'll just give you a little bit of percentages here. Of those that were there, there were approximately 60% that were saved, 40% by their own testimony, by their own admission, that were not saved. And of those, he began to ask, when did you get saved? 15% before they were 10 years old. 23% between ages of 10 and 14, and also between the ages of 14 and 16. Between the ages of 16 and 20, 38% above that, almost none. After the age of 20, there was another study done by the Barna Group that said only 6% of adult Christians made their decision to follow Christ after the age of 18. You say, preacher, y'all put a lot of emphasis on young people. Amen. You put a lot of emphasis on teenagers. You put a lot of emphasis on kids. Why do we spend so much time? Why do we spend so much money? Why do we invest ourselves so much? I'll tell you why. It's because the devil's trying to get this group. The devil's trying to get that crowd over there in that other building. He's trying to wreck their life and ruin their life. And I'm going to do everything I can to stand at the gate and to tell them and to let them know there's a God in heaven that loves them. There's a God in heaven that can change their life. Aren't you glad that God got a hold of you? However, when we do not regard God's altar, we can lose his touch. Think about Saul. Saul was somebody that God was using. I'm talking about Saul, the king. King Saul, the very first king. And it was somebody that God was using. However, he disobeyed God, and God pulled his hand off of him. You can lose your trophy. Esau, the Bible said, Esau was a profane man, and for just a morsel of bread, for a little bit of pottage, he sold his birthright. I wonder how many of us have wanted for the things of the world and said, you know what, it's worth whatever price that I have, whatever I have, I'll give it so I can have that, and you lose the touch of God. Young people, here we are a week or so removed. from our teen conference. And I know this because I live in the same world you live in. I live in the same flesh you live in. I can guarantee you this, the devil's done come by your house. The devil's done been coming knocking on your door. And he's been telling you all sorts of stuff. He's been luring you. He's been trying to get your attention, trying to get your affection. And you say, you know what? I might just give in this little bit. And maybe even this morning, you've lost the touch of God that was on you. Can I talk to moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas? It could be that we have lived loosely. We have done our own thing and done our own way, and we come to the house of God and we wonder why we can't feel God. We wonder why we don't have any peace. We wonder why our world's falling apart. Our family's in shambles. Our life's in a wreck. We wonder why. It's because we don't have the touch of God on our life. Y'all just might as well go to church with me. You can lose his touch. You lose your time. Think about Noah. Noah's neighbors. How many of y'all like to get woke up when you get to when you can sleep late? I remember in the summertime, we'd be there at the house and we'd be sleeping late, what I'm talking about. And sure enough, somebody done got some construction going. Somebody done had to have their roof redone. And you wake up and you hear, they're out there hammering on stuff. Now, why in the world are you waking me up? For 120 years. Kept hearing that hammer ringing. And he kept telling them, judgment's coming. It's going to rain. Flood's going to come. Get on the boat. I got time. They lost their time.
Amen.
Perhaps God's been hammering around, knocking around. And you just like, let me sleep. God, let me rest a while. I know if I get into that, and I know if I do that, then I'm going to have to work for you. I'm going to have to serve you. Let me say this. If you ever get saved, it's a joy to serve him. It's a joy to think the God of glory would look down at somebody like you and somebody like me and say, there's a vessel I can use. There's somebody I can use in my kingdom to do my work. Some of you might be right now, God's knocking on you, telling you, you know, it's time to step it up. You're saved. You're trying to live right. But God's telling you, it's time to do more. It's time to wake up. You know, it's funny to me how we can find time to do any other thing and every other thing. But when it comes time to doing God's work, I ain't got time for that. Well, you know, preacher, I'm just so tired. We wasn't tired, too tired to run around and do our own thing all day Saturday. I just got to have my rest on Sunday. Hallelujah. Y'all still love you, preacher. It's debatable. Amen. Lose your time. I'll give you this. Just turn over to Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5. Let me share this with you. Acts chapter number 5, the Bible said there in verse number 1, but a certain man named Ananias, with Sapphira, his wife, sold a possession and kept back part of the price. His wife also being privy to it and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. Now, what had happened is in chapter 4, some folk were they were selling what they had. They were trying to to give in to what was going on, what was happening there, and I don't have time to go through all that. But they were giving in to the house of God. And some people gave everything they had and just gave it all. There was no requirement to do so. They didn't have to do it, but everybody else was doing it, and they didn't want to look bad to anybody else. So Ananias and Sapphira come up with this plan. And we're going to tell them that we sold it for this amount when we know we got more than that, but we're going to give this amount, and it'll look like we gave everything. We'll be like them, but we'll have some in reserve in case this thing don't go right. We'll have some to fall back on. You know, I think pride is a big problem in serving God. I think the reason that a lot of us lie the way we do, the reason a lot of us act the way we do, is because we want other people to look at us and think more of us than we really are. God already knows all about you. God already knows who you are when nobody else sees. Why do you care? Why do you care what everybody else thinks about you? By the way, let me just go ahead and get it out right here. There's some of you that come to church and you got messed up lives. I'm thankful that you do. You are welcome here. You're messy. You're dirty. You got stuff. Thank God you're here. And I know there's some other people that are thankful that you're here. You don't have to come and put on a show. You don't have to come and put on some sort of regalia. You don't have to come and act like you're more than you are. Just come broken just like you are, and we'll love you all the way to Jesus. We'll help you. We'll bless you. We'll try to work alongside you. Why, preacher? Why do you think that that's that way? Because mercy and because grace can be scandalous at times. You know, think about this lady. Lady come washing the feet of Jesus. And everybody knew who she was. Everybody knew what she'd done to get the money to buy the stuff so she could put all that on Jesus' feet. They said, "Don't you know who she is?" He said, "Let her off. She's done this." Said, "I've been sitting here this whole time. There's a bunch of Pharisees around here. Not one of you has offered to wash my feet. Not one of you has offered me any kindness. And here comes a sinner. And she's going to fall down at my feet and wash my feet and give everything she had. You just leave her alone." Grace, by definition, is not deserved. You say, "Well, preacher, if I was a better Christian, if I was a better this, if I was a better that, then maybe people would love me more. Maybe I'd be promoted." Don't worry about letting people promote you. Let God promote you. Let God lift you up. The Bible says, "Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that in due season he shall exalt you." Hey, I don't care what man can do for me. I don't care what man has to offer me. What I do care about is the very God of heaven, how he can offer me the incentive plan he has for me, what he has to give to me. The Bible said they kept back part of the price. Kept that part of the price. You know, I find something that's happening here, and I don't have time to go into all this, but one thing I'll say is this. What they were doing is they were trying to build up something that God had no part in. God didn't want to be involved. God never said, "You have to do this for the kingdom to go forward." Did not Jesus say this? He said, "Upon this rock I will build my church. I will build my church. I will build my church. I will build my church." It's not up to a preacher. It's not up to a program. It's not up to some denomination. It's not a singer. It's not a situation, a deacon board, an elder board. It's nobody like that. But Jesus said, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail." they were, thought they was doing God a favor. God said, I'm not requiring this. Sometimes I feel like we get caught up in the idea of trying to build up something that God didn't want built. Remember Abraham? Abraham was promised a son. And he had a wife, Sarah, and they were barren. They were getting on up in years. Sarah said, hey, Abraham, I got a nurse. I got a servant. Why don't you, maybe God wants the child to come through her. Have Hagar. And they had a little boy, and his name was Ishmael. For 13 years, Ishmael was the one. But then God said, hold up. I told you I was going to give you a child, Sarah. And sure enough, Isaac comes along. And if y'all ever, you read through the Bible, you hear about that God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the children of Israel. Do you know who the descendants of Ishmael are? Those are the people that the Jews have been fighting with all this time. Because he decided he was going to do things his own way, it messed up everybody behind him. Listen, moms and dads, grandmas and grandpas. Because we decide we're going to live a certain way. Because we decide we're going to act a certain way. Because we decide we're going to do a certain thing. There's people behind us that will be affected by what we do today. Amen. Think about this. Ananias is standing there. He said, you've lied to the Holy Ghost. And fell dead. Sometimes I wish I had some of that apostolic power. Hallelujah. He said he lied to the Holy Ghost and he died right there. Here come the pallbearers. Take him out and went and buried him. 3 hours later, here comes his wife. Said they didn't talk together. They didn't talk to him like teenagers do. Now I'm going to say that we was here. I'm going to say that this happened. You back me up. You got my story, right? Years ago, God can believe this. You'll never believe this with your pastor. But I had a friend, and his daddy was a pastor. And me and him were friends and all, but I was wanting to go somewhere that my mama didn't want me to go. And so I come up with this plan, this scheme, that I was going to call this friend that she would approve of. And I say I was going to come over to his house. And he said that I was coming over to his house. But I was going to go somewhere else. See, y'all think y'all slick, don't you? So we done been there. We bought the t-shirt. We've been through all of that stuff.
Amen.
I said, preacher, why are you so hard on teenagers? Because I was one. Well, long story short, they might... My plan fell all apart. Red was a little bit too inquiring of this friend that I was wanting to go hang out with. That thing didn't work out.
It never does.
Exactly right. It never does. But Sapphira came. They had the story straight. He said, did you and your husband sell your property for this amount? Oh, yeah. We sure did. We're going to give it all. He said, how? How have you put it in your heart to lie to me, to lie to all these people, and to lie to God? He said, the feet of the ones that carried your husband out are coming to get you. And she died. I said that to say this. We too often treat this thing of church as a game. It's just what we do to pass the time, to make ourselves feel like a better person, to make ourselves look better in the eyes of the community, in the eyes of our family, in the eyes of, of the people we work with, whatever the case may be. But there are people that are coming behind you that you've taught and you're teaching by your actions. Just do this and it's going to be okay. Just go and catch hold of the horns of the altar and it's going to be all right. Ask Joab. It wasn't all right. One day, the judgment of God will fall. One day, that little running down to the altar is not going to work. You say, preacher, you're awful hard. What I'm telling you is what God told me to tell you today. I believe that every one of us in this place, I want to come, go ahead and come to the end if you will. I believe that every one of us in this place, in this hour, I believe that we should give God what is right. You know how we do. Well, I couldn't afford to give this week, preacher, because I didn't have anything left. You're never going to have enough left. Until we learn to put God first, we'll never have enough left. Well, I was going to pray. I was going to read my Bible. But I got busy and this happened and that happened. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, His righteousness, and all these other things shall be added back to you. Ain't nothing wrong with all the other things as long as those things are not before Him. God is a jealous God. He wants first place in your life. He wants first place in my life. God can take what you have and He can bless it. Little boy had a little lunch and he didn't wait till he ate what he wanted. He said, Master, this is what I got. My mama packed me this lunch. It ain't but a couple of fish and some rolls. But you're welcome to it. You know what happened to that little boy, Miss Fraley? After that they had fed the 5,000 men, plus the women and children, after they fed all them all they wanted, the Bible said they took up 12 baskets full. He just had a little poke. For teenagers, that's a paper bag. He just had a little bitty lunch. And he said, God, I'll give it to you. And God let him walk home with a whole lot more than he ever started out with. Because he gave God what was first. He gave God what was right. What I would ask you today is this. Are you all in for God? Are you just giving God a part? Well, I'll make it look good. Everybody else will believe that I gave everything and I've given everything. I'm not asking you that. Would God say He's given all? Remember, Daniel, they said this, said, we'll come up with a plan. And we're going to say we gave it all. And whenever he asked him, he said, do not lie to anybody that really caused any great consequence, but you have lied to the Holy Ghost. How many times have we been found guilty of lying to the Holy Ghost? Saying, God, give them all, but there's that one area in your life that you're not going to open the door to. God, I repent. I'm sorry. But there's that one area in your life. You know if you get opportunity, you're going to go right back to it. There's going to come a time that the altar just won't work. want you to stand with me all over the building. Help her on that with that microphone. We'll do that song, Passing It On. Hold Jesus' name. In 1868, there was a prison service that was held. And I believe it was Fanny Crosby wrote this song, and she's singing this song and said the prisoner cried out, "Oh Lord, don't pass me by." Went home and wrote this song, "Pass Me Not, Oh Gentle Savior." Here, I wonder, right now she begins to sing, I wonder how many of us have fought, come out of our seats, come and make a way to the altar, and say, "Oh God, help me. God, I want to make things right with you this morning." Oh, you're saved and you know it, but there's some areas in your life you're not right. You're not where you need to be. I wonder how many of us will say, "Oh God, oh God, have mercy on me." While you can be found, while you're calling, while you're speaking, "Lord, here I come." How many of us will say, "God, help me"?
Where you are.
we're not ready to meet Him. I want to pray a prayer that somebody led me in getting close to 30 years ago now. And that prayer changed my life. Oh, it wasn't the words they said, but it was when my heart turned and God stepped in. If God's speaking to your heart right now, I want you to follow me in this prayer. Dear Jesus, I know I've failed you. I've sinned, I'm a sinner, and I know it. Please forgive me. Come into my heart. Change my life. Save me. I need you in my life. Oh, I believe you love me. I believe you died for me. And I'm asking you now to save me. I love you, Jesus. Thank you for saving me. With heads bowed and eyes closed, if you pray a prayer like that and you meant it in your heart, or if you just slip your hand up, preacher, I ask the Lord to be my Savior just now. Is there anybody like that? Preacher, I ask Jesus to be my Savior and be my Lord. If you want to talk to me afterward, you're certainly welcome to. I feel like I've done what God would have us to do. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, I pray that you'd help. I pray that, God, you'd be with us. I pray that, God, you would help us as we go. Have your will, have your way in what's done. We thank you for the word. Thank you for all that you do. God, we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, let's do this. We're going to receive our first time guest. I have no idea. There we are. The green team. Praise the Lord. I bet y'all planned that day. Anyway, we appreciate Miss Midge and Brother Terry. And I want you to continue to remember Miss Carolyn in prayer. Also, Lynn. But do this right now. Hold your card up. Kelly, hold on. I'm going to need you to help me. So hold your card up. And they'll come by, they'll shake your hand, they'll pick that up for you. We're going to have a time of hospitality set up there, some refreshments, and we'd love to get to know you. We need to help Miss Midge to be an encouragement, help to Carolyn as well as her family. We're going to start a meal train this week. We need to cover every night of this week. And so, Kelly, I need you to be back there at the back. And if you want to be involved in that, let her know not what night that you can do that. And you can get in touch with her, and she'll get back in touch with you, and we'll take care of that. Also, Miss Leah is standing out. We need 18 volunteers. When I say 18 volunteers for Bible school, we needed about 30. Right now, we've got 12 that are committed. We've got 18 slots. You say, preacher, I can't come every night and serve every night. We've got it set up to where you can serve on the nights that you can. We've got slots available, and you can see Miss Leah. I need you to do that so we can have Bible school at the end of July. And so be sure to see her. Let her know what area you can serve in and do that. And finally, Philip. He wants to meet with any of the teen workers that are involved in teen ministry. If you have a heart to help in some areas of teen ministry, you can come and be part of that meeting as well right after the service. In fact, just meet up here, Philip. That'll probably work. So if you the teen workers, teen leaders, be sure to do that. All right. Are you glad you came to the house of the Lord today? All right. Tonight, we're going to be doing something special with the teenagers this evening, and we're giving you a couple weeks off of some things. We're going to have some Sunday night services throughout the summer for the church. However, in the fall, the Lord's been working on my heart about something, and And so I'll be sharing that with you as the days come ahead. But tonight, unless you're part of the team ministry, you have the night off. And so we appreciate you being here today. Come back and be with us on Wednesday. And we're looking forward to what the Lord's going to do Wednesday. We'll have a one-on-one, all that stuff. Our choir will be singing. Everything that we can do, we'll be doing on Wednesday. So come out and be with us on Wednesday. All right? Is that everything I need to say? Oh, we didn't have an offering, don't we? Praise the Lord. I forgot about that. Hallelujah. How can I forget about that? It's summertime, and we are broke. And so what that means is you need to be faithful in your giving. Amen. Summertime is always a difficult season at church. It really ought not be.
Amen.
It really ought not be. We ought to be faithful just like we are any time during the year. Hallelujah. Yeah, y'all probably ain't fooling. Amen. Fellas, all I can tell you is do the best you can. You give. If you didn't come prepared to give today, you can do that. You can go to the website, you can give there. You can use the app, and you can give there. Be faithful in your giving, and I know the Lord will bless you. And be faithful in that. God will take care of you. Seek ye first the kingdom of heaven. All these other things will be added unto you.